We welcome you to our worship service this morning. We hope that you are doing well, and we're grateful that you are worshiping with us today. It is Father's Day, and we wish a happy Father's Day to all of you. We hope this will be a day filled with love and joy for everyone. At this time, we will begin our worship.
Our call to worship is from the Psalms, the 116th Psalm, verses 1 and 2. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call on him as long as I live. Our hymn of praise is number 95, Jesus shall reign wherever the sun. Would you bow with me for the invocation and then join me praying the Lord's Prayer? Lord, more often than not, we feel we have to earn our salvation. It cannot be earned. Help us to trust you and to know that our salvation is a free gift of love from you. We pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our first lesson from the scripture comes from Matthew's gospel, beginning in chapter 9, verse 35, and going through chapter 10, verse 8. Listen for the word of the Lord. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment." Here ends the first reading from God's holy word. May he add his blessings to our understanding of it. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, as we are gathered in spirit, may your spirit bind us one to another. We lift our hearts to you with thanksgiving for all the blessings you have given to us. We thank you that even though we could do nothing to save ourselves, you did everything for us. We thank you that even though our backs were turned toward you and our lives were filled with sin, you still loved us enough that you were willing to endure pain and suffering and death for our sakes, so that we might turn to you when we saw such love and grace, and find the gift of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray, O Lord, that you will transform us by the power of your love, that we will not be vessels of sin and evil and condemnation, but that you will use us as vessels of love and grace and mercy and light, so that others might be drawn unto you, that they too might know the joys of the gift of life and love and joy that you alone can give. We ask that you forgive us of our sins, as you have so often done in the past. Strengthen us against temptation. Help us that we might do the things that are pleasing in your sight. Be with those who are sick, those who are recovering from accidents, those who are recovering from surgery. May your presence surround them, and may they know the joy of your love and presence always in every circumstance that they face. We pray your healing touch upon them in accordance with your will, that their health will be restored to them. We also pray that you be with those who have lost loved ones. Surround them with your love and comfort, and use us as instruments of love and comfort as well. We thank you for your church. We thank you for the body of believers that gather together, that support one another and give glory and honor to you. We know that we are far from perfect, that we do not know all that we should know. We do not do all the things that we should do. But we pray that in your presence we will have our eyes open to the mission you have given us to do, and that our lives will be strengthened and dedicated to doing your will. We pray, O Lord, for our nation and all nations upon the earth, that we will come to a knowledge of the truth, that we will work together to lift people up and not tear them down. We pray that the time will come that we will cross borders with hands and hearts and help one another. We pray that the time will come when we all can live together in peace. As we read and study your holy word, we pray that your Holy Spirit will give us insight and understanding. Give us the instructions we need that we might go forth and serve you. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our risen and exalted Lord. Amen. Our scripture text, the second lesson this morning, comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, beginning in verse 1 and going through verse 9. Or verse 8, excuse me. Listen for the word of the Lord. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Here ends the reading from God's holy word. May he add his blessings to our understanding of it. Let us pray. And now, O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our Redeemer and our strength. Amen. Last week, our scripture lesson was from Genesis, and we talked about Abraham. But you know, the text really was not so much about Abraham. Abraham was the human person involved there, but what the text really was about was what God was doing. It was about God and God's grace and mercy, not just to Abraham, but to the whole world. If you look at that text again back in Genesis, you will see that God was the actor. Time and time again, God blessed Abraham. God would make Abraham a great nation. God would make Abraham's name great. God would use Abraham so that through him all the nations of the earth would be blessed. One thing after another was something that Abraham could not have done in and of himself. He could not make himself into a great nation. He could not give himself offspring. He could not make himself a blessing to others, not the way God was going to do it. It was God who was acting in all of that. And sometimes we as Christians begin to focus more on ourselves and what we can do rather than on God and what God is doing for us and has done for us. Because God as he did for Abraham what Abraham could not have done, God also does for us the things that we cannot do. We cannot save ourselves. We cannot make ourselves into the kinds of people that we ought to be. We can cooperate with God, but God is the one who is able to bring us love and life and joy and salvation. He is the one who does for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And all too often in the scripture, we find people who, like us, are thinking about the things that they were able to do. And in the New Testament, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, often were thinking, well, you must do this, you must do this, you should do this. And we're like them quite often. The gospel message was a message of good news, a message of what God is doing for us, what God is accomplishing for us through Christ Jesus our Lord. It's not so much about us being able to do much. Even Jesus' disciples, time and time again, failed him. He taught and showed the example of what God was like, and the disciples didn't seem to understand it. The disciples, even though they were with Jesus and had the best teacher that ever has walked upon the face of the earth, they often didn't understand the teaching, and quite often they were at odds with one another over one thing or another. They were not perfect. In the scripture lesson from Matthew, Jesus was traveling from village to village. He was proclaiming good news. And he was healing those who had diseases. He was casting out demons. He was doing good for people. And in that text, if you remember when it was read a few moments ago, he looked and saw the crowds of people who had gathered. And you know, as I do, that if you have a crowd of people, you've got all kinds of people in that crowd. You've got some people there that would be interesting to know, some people that would be quite nice to have as friends and companions or associates. But there were also people in that crowd who are somewhat difficult to love. There were also people in that crowd who were self-centered. There were people in that crowd who were always negative. There were people in that crowd who were sinners greater than some of the rest. All of us are sinners. All in the crowd were sinners, but there were some, of course, who sinned in ways that were more blatant than others. And yet, what does the scripture say? It says Jesus looked at the crowd, and when he saw the crowd, he had compassion on them. He could see all the faults and failures out there. Every one of them had faults and failures. Some of them, as we said, far worse than others. And in spite of their sins, in spite of their failures, in spite of the ways that they lived, Jesus didn't condemn them. He looked at them with compassion. And his desire was to bring them all into the kingdom and the family of God. Even the church has been guilty of times of corrupting the good news. Jesus went preaching the good news, showing love, compassion to people, good and bad, all sinners. He did not come to condemn. He said in John's gospel, the Son of Man came not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And even the church has fallen into that error of taking the good news of the gospel and corrupting it and turning it into a condemnation of people. Condemning this group, condemning that group, condemning some other group. They have taken the good news of the gospel that Jesus will come and bless our lives and do for us what we cannot do for ourselves, and we've turned it into a works righteousness thing. We look at these over here. Well, you should do this. And those over there, well, you ought to be doing that instead of what you're doing. We have turned it into a message of condemnation. We have turned it into a message of you fix your own life. And that's not the way it is. We cannot fix our own lives. We can cooperate with the Lord who can fix our lives. Even in our politics today, people just relish that message of condemnation. Politicians get up and they spew all kinds of vile messages of condemnation of this group or that group or this person or that person because their views are different, their lifestyle is different or whatever. A message of condemnation. The poor ought to work harder. The sick ought to have prepared for their health care before they got sick. In so many ways, this one ought to have done something different than he did. We're always focusing on ourselves and what we can do or what we think we can do. Instead of turning our lives toward the one who loved us and has the power to help us become what we ought to be. We won't get there except he helps us. Our lesson from Paul's letter to the Romans reminds us of that God has done for us while we were still in sin. As in Matthew, Jesus looked at the crowds who were still in sin and he had compassion on them. He said, "The harvest is ready to be harvested, but the laborers are few." And you know what he did? He turned to his disciples, those feeble disciples, those who, in spite of all he had shown them and taught them, still did not understand things correctly, who still were not all that they ought to be. But he turned to his disciples and gave them authority to go out into some of the villages ahead of him and to heal the sick and to cast out demons and to proclaim the good news. He entrusted this message of good news to them, even though they were not perfect people. He knew that with the authority he would give them, the power he would give them, that they could do this. And the same is true for you and me. Yes, we are imperfect, but with the help of God, the love of God, desiring to bring forth the best from our lives, there is just no limit to the good that can be done through us. But it has all come because of God's initiative. Paul said, "Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, he had just been talking about Abraham again, talking about how God had done all these things for Abraham. And the only thing that Abraham did was trusted God, believed what God said, and then began to live his life accordingly. And the grace that we have from God, the promises that we have from God, are not dependent on what we can do. They are dependent on us trusting him to accomplish them in us and through us. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. In other words, this grace has come from God, this gift from God, not what we have done. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. And so what he's saying is that God has blessed us, God has turned to us, and if we just turn our face to him in repentance, if we let God do what he wants to do in our lives, then he will redeem even the bad things that happen in our lives. He's not saying that when we turn to God, that when God begins to bring salvation and love and grace and all of these things to our lives, that we will no longer be subject to the problems and the sufferings of this world. To the contrary, many of those who were Christians suffered because they were Christians. But Paul reminds us that the power of God is such that he can sustain us through that suffering, and not only that, can redeem those things, those evil things, so that good is brought forth from them. Suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. Hope does not disappoint us, not because of anything about us, again, but because God does not disappoint us. He has given us his Holy Spirit. His Holy Spirit is with us. We have not been forsaken. And the power of God is such that he will prevail, he will win, he will accomplish all that he desires to accomplish. And then Paul goes on to remind the Romans. He didn't know that he'd be reminding us 2,000 years later, but he does remind them and us through this writing, while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. God proves his love for us in that while we were sinners, still, Christ died for us. In other words, just like the passage in Matthew, the Lord looked at the crowd, saw them with all their faults and failures and sins and things that we would not even mention in church, and he still loved them, had compassion on them. And here Paul says, while we were still sinners, in other words, even though we had done nothing to earn God's favor, he favored us anyway. Even though our backs were still turned to him, his love for us was so great, the love of our Lord Jesus Christ so great, that he was willing even to suffer and die for us. Now that's a powerful love. It's not so hard for us to love others who love us. It's not too hard for us to love people who are something like us. But sometimes it's very difficult for us to love people who seem to do things contrary to what we believe, contrary to our likes, contrary to the ways we think things ought to be. Sometimes it's very difficult to love them, to love those who believe differently than we do, who live differently than we do. And so often we fall into that trap of condemnation. And it's not the gospel. I don't care who goes out and acts as if they're speaking on behalf of the Lord. If they are condemning people, then they are not acting as the Lord who had compassion on all, regardless of their fault. I hope we will remember that the Lord does for us what we cannot do for ourselves, and that we should not expect people to be able to make themselves better without the help of the Lord. All too often, we say to those people who are contrary to the way we think they ought to be, you need to try harder to get off alcohol. You need to try harder to get off drugs. You need to try harder to make you some money. And sometimes they can't. But the power of the Lord is such that He can help us do what we cannot do for ourselves. And so what we need to do, rather than condemn people, is pray for people and show them the love of Christ, the love of God, the mercy of God. And if they can see that love in action through us, then perhaps their hearts will be changed. God proves His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And that love was so powerful that even death had to yield to life because of the power of love. And when we see that His love for us is that strong, that while we are still in sin, while we were even nailing the nails into His hands and feet, He still loved us. When we see that kind of love, that powerful a love, how can we help but be transformed? How can we help but turn our hearts toward that love, that we might bask in its glow, that we might receive life that even death cannot take away? We thank God for a love that powerful. Had His love been weak, then He would have been the one to condemn. He would have been the one to destroy the world. We would not even exist to this day. In His anger, in His disappointment, in His condemnation, we would have perished. But His love extended to us even while we were still sinners. If while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by His life. Thanks be to God that He has done for us what we cannot do for ourselves, that He has loved us in spite of our unworthiness, that He has offered us the gift of life, though we can do nothing to earn it. Thank you. We come to the table of the Lord because of what Christ has done for us. We come here and give thanks that He has accomplished for us what we cannot, could not accomplish for ourselves. We come to the table of the Lord because He has invited us. We come and partake of bread, remembering how He gave His life, His body over to suffering and death, that we might have life. We drink from this cup and remember how He shed His own blood because of us and for us. He loved us in spite of our sin, and while we were yet sinners, He gave Himself for us. That is a love more powerful than what words can really describe. But we give thanks to God that He has included us in His family. We give thanks to God that even though we could not perfect ourselves, He has cleansed us from unrighteousness. May we pray. Lord, as we gather at this table, we recall that we have not earned our place here. It is a gift of Your love and grace. At this table, we remember that our Lord, while we were still in sin, in rebellion against You, our Lord laid down His life for us. At this table, we remember that not only did He give His life, but His love was so powerful that death could not hold Him. And on the third day, He returned to us and is here present with us at this table as the host, the one who has provided this meal for us. We thank You and pray that You will help us to turn to You, that You will help us to trust in You, that You will help us to yield ourselves to Your love, that Your love might transform us into all You want us to be. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we recall, on the same night that the Lord Jesus was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And in a like manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when He had blessed it, He gave it to His disciples, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in My blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sin. Drink you this and remember that Christ died for you, and be thankful." Let us pray. Lord, for the gift of Your life, for the gift of love that was extended to us even though we had not earned it, for the gift of a love so powerful that even death could not hold you. And even death cannot have power over us because of your love. We give you thanks. May our lives be reflection of your compassion, your love, your mercy, your grace. Help us that we will be instruments through which good news is proclaimed. The good news of your love for all people and your salvation that is extended to all who will receive it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the Lord our Maker, be all honor and glory, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.